Hello, wonderful friends. Welcome to Ted Russ Ministries for October 13th, 2024. We begin the powerful name of the Father who created us, the Son who died for us, and the Spirit who lives within us now, forever and ever. Amen. Our first reading for today is from Amos chapter 5. Seek the Lord and live, or he will break out against the house of Joseph like fire, and it will devour Bethel, with no one to quench it. Ah, you that turn justice to wormwood and bring righteousness to the ground. They hate the one who reproves in the gate, and they abhor the one who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor and take from them levies of grain, you have built houses of hewn stone, but you shall not live in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions, and how great are your sins. Yet you who afflict the righteous, who take a bribe, and push aside the needy in the gate. Therefore the prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live, and so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you, just as you have said. Hate evil and love good. Establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. Here ends the reading. The second reading is from Hebrews chapter 4, reading verses 12 through 16. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing into it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before God, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare through the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Here ends the second reading. Our gospel lesson from Mark chapter 10, reading verses 17 to 31. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." The man said, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus then, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go sell all you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." When the rich young man heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And all the disciples were perplexed by these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to each other, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals, it is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you, Jesus." But Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house, brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake or for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children in fields with persecutions, but in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. Our first song is Thy Word. Please sing it with me. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, the guide knows my way. A young preacher was contacted by a local funeral director to preside over a graveside service at the small cemetery for someone with no family and no friends. The pastor agreed to this. He started out very early, but got himself lost, making several wrong turns along the way. So the pastor arrived a half an hour late. The hearse was nowhere in sight, and the workmen were eating lunch. But the pastor went to the graveside and saw the vault was already in place. Taking out his Bible and his Lutheran hymnal, he conducted the entire service, never skipped a part. As he was returning to his car, he did overhear one of the workers say, "Do you think we should tell him it's a septic tank?" For God, all things are possible. Some people think that's a joke or a foolish thought, but it's not a joke and it's not an opinion. It is the truth Jesus shares with us in today's gospel reading. Jesus says in Mark 10:27, "For God, all things are possible." The text refers primarily to salvation because salvation is totally the work of God. Not my work or your work, but the work of God. Every attempt to enter the kingdom on the basis of achievement or merit, the Bible teaches, is false. The rich man in our story who comes to ask Jesus what he should do to inherit eternal life is a very good man, sincere in his asking. Mark's gospel is the only one which says that Jesus looked at this man and loved him immediately. Out of love, then, not as judgment, Jesus offers this rich man an open door to life. Sell all you own and give it to the poor, Jesus says. We find this in Mark 10, verse 21. Of course, our American culture today bombards all of us with the message that we will find life by consuming. Our Christian assemblies counter this message with the invitation to find life by divesting for the sake of your neighbor in need. It's tempting to view the gospel text as a cautionary tale. First, Jesus gave instructions. Secondly, the man didn't follow the instructions. Third, so don't be like him. But if the person in this Mark 10 story has a failing, it's probably true for all of us. The key question isn't why the rich man didn't pass the test, but whether any of us could pass the same test. Today's gospel story reminds us that instead of trusting in God's works, it's easier to substitute our works. Like the man, we minimize God's accomplishments, creation, the cross, death on the cross, resurrection, overcoming evil with his love and his gift of eternal life. We minimize all of that to focus faith ideas that favor us. Our goodness, our morality, our legalism, our believing correctly, and so forth. It would be like us watching our favorite football team on TV win the game, then putting on a uniform ourselves and claiming it isn't over yet until we have suited up and run onto the field. We cannot overcome our doubts and fears on our own. The man in Mark 10 had them, Peter had them, Mary had them, we all have them. When we cannot eliminate fears and doubts, we trust that God exists, that God loves us, even in the midst of things we cannot fully understand. Like the man in our text today, we are tempted to separate faith and self-power. How popular today we claim, faith is a part of my life. But note the boundaries between faith and socioeconomic identity in that popular but glib phrase. Whose life is it really? Did we give ourselves life? Of course not. God does not view us compartmentalized, nor does God's kingdom ultimately coexist among lesser rivals, such as our false gods and our personal kingdoms. As long as we view our life through the lens of our power, we will see no further than the man did in Mark chapter 10. Today's Old Testament reading is from Amos. Amos describes what Jesus does, urging us to seek the Lord and live, lest God break out against our houses. We find this in Amos 5, verse 6. Like Jesus, Amos laments the twisted vision of humanity that always focuses on itself. A most chilling depiction of the sinful power of wealth comes in the movie All the Money in the World. In this movie, actor Mark Wahlberg's character asks J. Paul Getty, played by Christopher Plummer, "No one has ever been richer than you. At this moment, what would it take for you to feel secure?" Getty simply replies with one word, "More! More!" Friends, less is more in the kingdom of God. Plenty of money, plenty of comforts don't buy us peace and joy Only God's grace and Spirit can give us this. In Mark chapter 10, 70 and 31, Jesus looked at the rich young man and loved him. Jesus loved him. This is the most vital part of the story. So out of love, not judgment, our Lord offers the rich young man an open door to real life. Jesus says, sell your own and give it to the poor. The young man's primary problem was his wealth. So our Lord's prescription was to rid him of this wealth. There is no indication that Jesus' command to this man was meant for all Christians. It applies only to those who have the same spiritual problem, and many do in 2024. I believe the number one problem in our world today is greed. Please listen to Mark 10, 21 to 22. Jesus, looking at the rich young man, loved him and said, you lack one thing, go sell what you own, give it the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. When the rich man heard that this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. This treasure in heaven Jesus talks about is, of course, the gift of forgiveness of sins, eternal life, or salvation. This treasure is not to be earned by self-denial or giving of one material goods. In giving away his wealth, the rich young man would have removed the obstacle that kept him from trusting and following Jesus Christ. So, for us today, the Bible says, for God, all things are possible. It is possible for all of us to be more generous, especially when so many in our country and world have less. It is possible for us to be more thankful for our life, our time, our health, God's forgiveness for all our sins, and the precious gift of eternal life. It is possible to quit judging others so harshly while we make excuses for our own sin and selfishness and laziness. It is possible for us to dream new dreams, see new visions for ourselves, our family, our church, and our nation. It begins not with someone else. It begins with me. It begins with you. Quit blaming and start blessing. So, if it's true that for God all things are possible, why aren't we full of faith and joy and peace and vision? One of my favorite hymns captures this grace, power, and joy in today's text from Mark 10. Bring to the sacred altar the gifts his goodness gave, the golden sheaves of harvest, the souls Christ's guide to save. Your hearts lay down before Christ when at his feet you fall, and with your lives adore him who gave his life for all. For God, all things are possible. That's the good news today, my friend. Amen. Now our next song is Our God, Our Help in Ages Past. From the today after each petition ends with, God of grace, your response is, hear our prayer. Challenged by God's word in Christ today, let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. Compassionate God, embolden the church to seek all who are lost. Clothe those who are naked, mend what is broken. We especially pray for storm victims in Florida, North Carolina, Georgia, Tennessee, other places. May we be generous bearers of your eternal love and grace. God of grace, hear our prayer. Sustaining God, as we approach harvest time, we pray for farmers, field workers, and those who process crops. Keep us mindful of environmental threats, the nourishing food that feeds the world. God of grace, hear our prayer. Steadfast God, inspire world leaders to share resources and work collectively to end global poverty, starvation, and preventable disease. Direct us to seek justice and equity, that all may live in peace. We especially pray for peace in Israel and peace in Ukraine. God of grace, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for those who are afflicted, tormented, grieving, oppressed, and lonely, especially for any of our listeners or friends and family members of our listeners who we name now, silently or aloud. We thank you for the healing that David Brown's experienced. We thank you for the resurrection to eternal life that Ann Rust has recently experienced. Hear our prayers for any one of our friends and family members who are sick today. Deliver the strength of your love, healing, and compassion to all who need it now. God of grace, hear our prayer. Generous God, we give thanks for the First Nations and tribes who inhabited this great land. We lament the harm done by colonization. Call us to deeper appreciation and care for the languages, rituals, and history of all Indigenous people. God of grace, hear our prayer. Ever-living God, we rejoice to be heirs of the eternal life made real in Jesus' death and resurrection. We give thanks for saints of all times and places, especially this day, for the life and ministry of Anne Marie Haller Rust. We know these saints, first and last, who still inspire us in faithful living. God of grace, hear our prayer. Into your hands, loving God, we commend all for we pray this day, trusting in the saving grace you freely give, both now and forever. Amen. Our closing song is I Want to Walk in the Light of Christ. Sing it with me, friend. So many wonderful friends and loved ones last weekend while we were up for the celebration of life and resurrection, the funeral of my mother Anne. So many wonderful friends and family members were there from Iowa and Ohio and Sweden and all over the country. God bless you. Thanks for listening. Hope you join me next weekend for another positive message from God's holy word. Go in peace. Follow Jesus. Amen.